My name is Jenni Owen. I'm the Director of Policy Engagement and on the faculty at the Sanford School of Public Policy at Duke. We already had lots of comments about people being stressed out about wearing Duke name tags. I apologize for that. If you want to flip it over and put your name on the other side, that's perfectly fine. I understand. This is actually the 10th Family Impact Seminar in North Carolina, which I realized as we were starting the planning for this. We started them in 2005, and for those of you who aren't familiar with the Family Impact Seminar model and network, there's a summary in your folders, but I'll just say very briefly that the purpose of Family Impact Seminars is to try to provide research-based, evidence-based, data-driven information, not solutions necessarily, but strategies and options for policymakers at all levels to help them make better decisions in areas that have an impact on families. And we have some elected officials here. We'll recognize them in just a minute. But just as our elected officials are asked to do environmental impact assessments and economic impact assessments, there are people who wonder 25 or so years ago when these family impact seminars started, why can't we do family impact assessments? Why not assess every piece of legislation for its impact on families? And so that's the real principle behind family impact seminars. And of course, we all do our assessments differently, and there's a lot of discussion around how that might work, but that's the principle behind it. There are now over 20 states. Family Impact Seminar started as a national model. It was only done at the congressional executive branch level at the federal level, and then transitioned to being state seminars. So there are now over 20 states across this country that do Family Impact Seminars on an annual basis or semi-annual basis. I want to say a few words of thanks. Number one, top of the list, thanks goes to Susan Fusness from the Public Consulting Group, who actually worked on a Family Impact Seminar a couple of years ago, or a few years ago, when she was a student at the Sanford School. Who knew that she'd be leading one of these a few years later? But really grateful to Susan and all of her support with pulling this together. A lot of you have heard from her in different ways. So thanks so much to her. She brought her colleague, Michael Weckler, who has also been working on this, and we thank him. Lynette Edgerton, who works with me at the Sanford School, and the Casey Foundation for actually funding a number of states to do these seminars, which we're really appreciative for that, and the Family Impact Seminar Institute, which was based at Purdue University. I would really appreciate, or we would appreciate it, if all of the, you know, everyone here is important, you all do such great work. We especially wanted to recognize the public employees, so state and county employees and elected officials, if you would wave or stand or whatever you might do. Some of you are at the table. This is really about your work and what you do to support children and families across the state and more broadly. And my real motive for doing this seminar was to get to see people I used to work with at State DSS almost 20 years ago. So accomplished that. So that makes me very happy. And of course, our speakers, taking time out of their busy days and calendars. We have an honored guest and speaker sitting at the front table here, who you'll hear from at the end. So thank you all so much for doing that. And I will now introduce Senator Tamara Barringer, who is here to give us welcoming remarks. And I will note that she actually was willing and able to give us welcoming remarks at the first Family Impact Seminar on foster care that we did about a year and a half ago. So I have learned over the years and watching her work and what she cares about her investment in children, her own personal involvement with foster care, the recognitions she's received from statewide and local organizations. And I said to her, I know it's a pretty busy time right now. And she said, yeah, this is why I'm here, though. This is why I do the work I do, is because of the kids and the families and the workers in the room and people who invest so much in various systems that have an impact on families all across North Carolina. I asked her what she wanted me to share, anything in particular, and I hope you don't mind, that she said, well, look at this. And she showed me this chart of her bills that she has introduced over the years and pointed out to me how many of them have passed with unanimous and bipartisan support. And really emphasized for me, which I wanted to share with you, that one of the things that I think has made her so successful is the fact, she said, I don't work across the aisle, I work in the aisle. So I thought that was a really nice statement. And with that, I will turn it over for you to give us welcoming remarks. Thanks so much.
Thank you so much. It's truly an honor, a privilege, and it's really humbling to be here before you today. Thank you for allowing me a few moments to welcome you. Most of you, or many of you in the room, know me because we've worked long hours, long nights, weekends for this very thing, families and children in North Carolina. I've become very well aware of how critical this work is, and it all started about 20 years ago when my husband and I were therapeutic foster parents with the Methodist Home for Children. Our guardian angel is sitting in the room right now, Catherine Joyner. She was our social worker, and she knows how difficult and challenging, and you all do, how difficult and challenging that work is. I came from a very modest family. I've said publicly, and it's true, my daddy was a farmer. My first home didn't have indoor plumbing. But the one thing I had going for me, actually the two things I had going for me, was a strong family and strong public education. I would not be here today if it were not for both of those. Now, having come from such a strong family, I had no idea what it must be like to not have that family until my husband and I were called to be therapeutic foster parents. We had children in our home that had been locked in closets and not fed, had been beaten, had broken bones, and many of them were not over the age of five. They were tiny. They were children. And we did this for 10 years. And frankly, I saw things I wish I had not seen. I wish I could have unseen them, but having seen them, I cannot remain quiet. And after the 10 years, my husband and I decided that when an opportunity for me to serve came about, whether it be in the judiciary system or in the legislative branch, that I would step forward and do that. And 5 years ago, the opportunity to serve as North Carolina Senator presented itself. I won my election. I was first appointed, then I won my election. And since then, I have worked tirelessly for the children and families of North Carolina. I have my partner in all of that is here today, Representative Sarah Stevens. And she and I together, she's in the House of Representatives and I'm in the Senate. And I'm very happy and very pleased and proud of the fact that I actually sat down with Karen McLeod, those of you, many of you know her, and actually drafted by hand what we call the Foster Care Family Act. Some of you call it normalcy, but now in North Carolina, a foster parent can sign a permission slip for a child so that they do not sit marginalized in the office, in the principal's office, like someone who could not earn the opportunity to come to the legislature or to the Biltmore House or even to the local fire department. Foster children have the opportunity to learn to drive, although we need to work on that some more, but we work tirelessly, Representative Stevens and I did, with the Rate Bureau just to be able to have insurance available for that to happen. I have a lot of good plans about that. But imagine being turned out at the age of 18 in North Carolina and not being able to drive. How in the world are you ever going to get to work, be able to have a job? Well, I'm happy to say that Representative Stevens and I work together, and foster care to 21 is the law in North Carolina. Yes. I'm now working very diligently, as she is, with Department of Health and Human Services and you folks on the ground. I'm already making plans to visit Rutherford County to talk to the people, you, who are actually implementing this, because we're working hard to get this implemented. And the staff of the General Assembly is here, and I cannot speak without recognizing how hard they have worked to make this happen. In closing, what I'd like to do is share with you, and I'll tell you, it's not easy being in the public space. And you know that too, because many of you live in the public space. And you can get discouraged sometimes. But I do believe, I'm a woman of faith, and I do believe things happen almost always for a reason. And my husband and I were driving back, and by the way, one of my favorite movie quotes is the Tom Hanks, "There's no crying in baseball." But I'm reminding myself there's no crying in the Senate. But I want to share this with you because it is what's gotten me through the last week. My husband and I were driving back from an event that we were at Charlotte. And we stopped by, which was very uncharacteristic because we generally don't eat enough, or at least I don't eat an awful lot of Bojangles, but for whatever reason, I really wanted Bojangles that night. And it was late, it was almost midnight, and I wasn't even sure if the Bojangles would be open. And we stopped in one of the small towns between here and Charlotte. And the restaurant was closed. We were going to go in, but the drive-thru was open. So we went to the drive-thru, and we're sitting in the line. There was a car ahead of us. My husband had already rolled his window down, ready to place his order. And this young man wandered up to the car. And he asked, "Do you have, sir, do you have any change?" And of course, we both knew that we couldn't give this young man, this actually child, money, because we didn't know what would happen. So he said thank you and turned and walked away. I reached over to Brent and I said, Brent, see if you want something to eat.
Yeah.
That's my husband. And Brent yelled over, he said, would you like a meal? Would you like something to eat? And he came back to the car and he said, oh, that would be wonderful. And Brent said, well, what would you like to have? And he said, oh, anything. Well, let me tell you, we bought him the biggest grand size meal you could possibly get. And then we asked him what he wanted to drink, and he said tea, and then he backed up and said, oh, water would be fine. Well, we got him tea, and we got him water, and we got the big gulp. And we took that opportunity to ask him a little bit about himself. And we asked him his name, and he is no longer a nameless, homeless child. The young gentleman is Roma Frost. And we asked him, well, what are you doing out this late? And I know that you don't always get the real story from these folks, but he said he had been thrown out of his home, that he'd been turned in. Again, I know, you never know, but for whatever reason, he was homeless. And we said, how old are you? And he said, I'm 19. I don't think I believe that. I don't believe he was a day over 15 years old. He was very young, very vulnerable. Fortunately, because I know an awful lot of you in the room, I picked up the phone very quickly and called the Department of Social Service manager in that area, and she immediately dispatched people out. And even though what we saw as I turned and we drove off, we saw him sit down on the curb behind that Bojangles in the dark and ravenously eating that meal, by the time that person from DSS got there, he had vanished. He was gone. And I followed up today, and they're still searching for Roma Frost. But what I leave you with today, ladies and gentlemen, is the work you do in your counties, in your cities, in your municipalities, in the General Assembly. What we do is critical for the future of North Carolina. We don't need any Roma Frosts out there. We've got to find them. We've got to figure this thing out together. My last remark will be from my good friend, from the Grand Ole Opry, Jimmy Wayne, who came and fought with us to get foster care to 21 done. And he did, and he was as good as his word. And what he says and what I now say and attribute to him, that children are 30% of our population, but 100% of our future. And it's in our hands. Thank you.
That is a tough act to follow. Thank you so much, Senator Barringer. I'm Susan Fusnes. I'm a senior consultant with PCG, and it's my honor to get to introduce our speakers for this afternoon's program. But before I do, I want to again thank Senator Barringer for her remarks and for her continued advocacy on behalf of children, and also acknowledge Representative Stevens here, who is partners in crime with Senator Barringer and does wonderful work for children, including co-chairing the Committee on Homeless Youth, Foster Care, and Dependency. Thank you both so much for your work. It's my pleasure to introduce the four panelists sitting in front of you and share a little bit about their background. After each one speaks, feel free to ask any clarification questions that you have for them, but we'll save the Q&A for after all the panelists have spoken. Each of these four panelists brings expertise in child welfare and substance abuse, from their frontline experiences to being an administrator or a consultant. They'll share information on this theme of substance abuse and child welfare, sort of ranging from the macro to the micro perspective, touching on federal policy and state and local program examples along the way. After the panel, we are honored to have Titianna Goings from SESO speak about her experiences and give us some final remarks as well. On to the introductions. Starting with Heather Baker, who leads Public Consulting Group's Human Services National Child Welfare and Youth Practice. Ms. Baker works with child welfare agencies to invest in programs, people, and technologies that improve the lives of children and families. For example, she and her team are now working in Michigan to help the state and the provider community jointly establish performance-based contracting models that give providers more flexibility and autonomy to improve outcomes in their communities. Ms. Baker has a background in state government finance and worked under three administrations in the governor's budget office in Massachusetts. She leads a talented team of former child welfare administrators and practitioners to help public agencies make connections between their fiscal operations and their programs so that agencies can invest in services that work. Following Ms. Baker, we have Ken DeCerchio. Ken DeCerchio has over 35 years of experience managing community-based substance abuse and mental health services, including the last 9 years as a technical assistance consultant. Currently, Mr. DeCerchio is a program director for the Center for Children and Family Futures, which operates the National Center for Substance Abuse and Child Welfare. His primary areas of responsibility include the Children's Bureau's Regional Partnership Grant Program and SAMHSA's Family Drug Treatment Court's Performance Management Program. He served as a Florida State Substance Abuse Director and the department with the Department of Children and Family Services from 1995 to 2005, when he was appointed as the Assistant Secretary for Substance Abuse and Mental Health. Mr. DeCerchio is a certified addictions professional in Florida. In November 2001, Governor Bush appointed Mr. DeCerchio as Deputy Director for treatment to the Florida Office of Drug Control. In 2004, Mr. DeCerchio was appointed by the Secretary Tommy Thompson to serve on SAMHSA's Center for Substance Abuse Treatment National Advisory Council. In 2005, he received the National Association of Alcohol and Drug Abuse Directors Service Award for his leadership and support in the substance abuse prevention and treatment field. In August 2007, the Florida Alcohol and Drug Abuse Association awarded Mr. DeCerchio its Lifetime Achievement Award for his contributions to prevention and treatment services in Florida. And if that wasn't enough, he's also a volunteer guardian ad litem in Florida's Second Judicial Court. Following Ken, I'm pleased to introduce Tina Willauer. Tina Willauer is the director for Kentucky Sobriety Treatment and Recovery Teams, or Case Start Program, for the Department of Community-Based Services in Kentucky. In this role, Ms. Willauer oversees the development, implementation, and administration of START and serves as a resource and consultant providing technical assistance for matters of child protective services, substance abuse, and program administration. Ms. Willauer obtained her master's degree in public administration from Cleveland State University and bachelor's degree in criminal justice from Bowling Green State University. She was instrumental in developing, implementing, managing, and leading the nationally recognized START program in Cleveland, Ohio. I'll add that she also testified in front of Congress recently on this program. Ms. Willauer has devoted her career to serving children and families and brings a unique perspective based on 25 years of experience in the child welfare field. She served as a frontline social worker, a supervisor, a senior manager, a program director, and consultant within the public child welfare system with a focus on Child Force University and the University of North Carolina School of Law. Judge Carmichael has served as both president of the North Carolina Association of District Court Judges and the North Carolina Conference of Chief District Court Judges. Please join me in welcoming our very esteemed panel.
And I'll turn it over to Ms. Baker.
Okay. All right. I think it's on.
Get close. Just get close.
Is it on? You guys can hear me? Okay. So I'm going to mostly focus on some federal policy and funding around how child welfare services are funded, both now and some potential changes for the future. I want to focus mostly on how we have seen the capacity for services that are provided to children in the child welfare system. It sort of follows what the feds are willing to pay for. So I'm going to talk a little bit about 4E first and then talk about the Family First Prevention Services Act, which has been approved by the House and is currently pending a vote in the Senate. So for a little bit of a backdrop, you all, I'm sure, are familiar with Title 4E as it exists now. It is the primary funding source for child welfare services. And just in case there's any early childhood folks in the audience, I just want to be clear that when I say child welfare services, I mean services that are provided to children sort of at the point of a case being opened through a hotline call or through interaction with child protective services. And when I say prevention services in the context of this conversation, I'm talking about services that prevent entry into foster care. And so when I talk about Family First, it would be wonderful if Family First also authorized funding for families before they even hit the hotline and maltreatment has been substantiated. But within the context of the Family First Act, it's within Child Welfare Services. So historically, 4E has grown out of the AFDC program. So AFDC, our former welfare program, authorized had a foster care component that was authorized in around 1960, 1961. And the way that foster care was funded through AFDC was essentially that if a child was living with a family who was in receipt of AFDC, was removed from that home and placed into an out-of-home care placement, into foster care, AFDC allowed that federal funding to follow that child into care. And so the beginning of real, tangible foster care funding from the federal governments to the states was happening in the context of AFDC. And it was entirely associated with the placement of a child into foster care. In 1980, the Title IV-E Act, Title IV-E was created as a section of the Social Security Act. And it continued this concept that the federal government was working to fund placement of children into foster care. And it just simply pulled that function out of the welfare system and into its own child welfare system. And that is why we talk a lot about AFDC being linked with foster care. There's still some eligibility links to AFDC. But one of the primary critiques of Title IV-E over the years has been that it does not provide services for doesn't provide funding for services that prevent entry into foster care. And the reason for that is just the way that 4E came about to begin with. As since 1960 until this very day, we've seen several changes to Title IV-E over time. And what we have definitely seen is an enormous growth in the capacity of state and local government to provide foster care and to provide the kinds of case management services that are associated with foster care. We see an enormous amount of federal oversight on the foster care program. We see a great deal of federal investment into foster care, but we haven't seen the feds really make any significant investments in prevention services. There are small programs, but not significant investments in prevention services. And so I say all of that to set the stage for why the Family First Prevention Services Act is such a significant piece of legislation. It's pending. It's not the law yet, just to be clear. So what does the Family First Prevention Services Act do? It's important for this conversation because it's the first time that we've seen specific legislation that would allow Title IV-E to fund substance abuse prevention and treatment services. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about how that works. There's two really big components to the act. One has to do with prevention services, and one has to do with how Title IV-E funds congregate care services or residential placements. I'm not going to talk about that as much. I'm going to talk about prevention services. So what the act does is it allows for states to cover certain types of prevention services for children engaged in the child welfare system under a whole bunch of conditions. There are conditions around what kinds of children and families can be served, and this is typical of any large federal entitlement program. There's restrictions around who can be funded, what types of families can receive funding, and then about the types of services that can be funded. So who's in the eligible population? Children and families where a child has been identified by the child welfare agency as at risk for placement in foster care, and that risk is documented in a prevention plan, and that the prevention plan authorizes the service that's to be provided. And I go through that, and there are some other elements. Pregnant and parenting teens are also a covered population. I go through all of those requirements because one of the challenges of implementing any major change in what the feds will cover is all of the administrative tasks that go along with it. And some of the challenges in implementation have to do with, you know, how is the county or the state documenting that the child's at risk? How is the prevention plan developed? What is the timeline for the prevention plan to be developed? How is the service referral completed in the prevention plan? And so all of that is work that states and counties have to do to be able to access the federal funding if it becomes available. So that's the high level who can receive the service. It's those children and their families. And then the types of services that are covered are mental health services, substance abuse prevention and treatment services, and in-home family support services. So a wide range of services that are intended to prevent placement into foster care. Now here's the hard part. This is the hard part. The services have to have an evidence base. We have seen the federal government in human services and in healthcare moving towards funding and supporting evidence-based practices. We have a long history, both in the United States and internationally, of, you know, having human services in particular programs that have very little evidence that they actually work. And there is a growing desire to make investments in programs that have an evidence base. Well, having an evidence base is not very easy. And the source, the Act requires, has three definitions of the evidence bases that are required. Well-supported, which it would take me 10 minutes to read all of the requirements and how well-supported is defined and supported and promising, but those are the three categories, and well-supported is the most rigorous. It requires random control trials, it requires more than one study, and 50% of the services that Title IV would cover have to be well-supported practices. And I raise that because regardless of whether the Family First Prevention Services Act is in fact the legislation that passes, we are in a situation right now where sometime between today and October 1st, 2019, the feds are going to have to pass some kind of federal finance reform legislation, because there are 20 plus states right now who are operating under Title IV waivers, and those waivers expire. So something is going to have to happen. And Family First, along with a lot of other indicators, give us a clear sense that whatever ends up passing is going to require practices that have an evidence base. And so there's quite a bit of work to be done, because even practices that have been demonstrated to have an evidence base that exist for children and families in child welfare, a lot of those practices are still in the promising or supported practice category. So from now until this act comes into play or whatever follows it, we have a lot of work to do to be working with our research community and partners and with our the developers of these practices to diversify and improve the amount of services that are available that meet the needs of children and families that also are based in research. And I think that's all I'm going to say. I wanted to try to keep it to 10 minutes myself, because I think what everybody else has to say is really very interesting. So if folks have questions about Family First, I can take them at the end or afterwards.
So call your senators.
Call your senators.
There's about an 8-day window, and if it doesn't happen this session, then it's not likely to happen, or it's going to be, because it's an election, and it'll be all new committee members and committee chairs, and it's kind of starting from scratch again. And it's really kind of up in the air, and really the most substantial piece of legislation that we think can support children and families to come around in a long, long time. And the four waivers, like you said, Heather, go away.
Yeah, if you know any Texans, have them call their senator, because that's critical. Yeah.
So it's nice to be back in Raleigh. I work for Children and Family Futures, which is out of Southern California, but I've lived in North Florida, Tallahassee area, for almost 40 years. We have, 15 minutes? I grew up in Philadelphia. Italian background, so I can speak fast and loud, and I'm going to try to do that and cover most of the talking points. Tina mentioned, or your introduction mentioned, that Tina testified before the Senate Congressional Committee, in part around opioid abuse and pending legislation. Our director Nancy Young did as well. We did Hill briefings this past fall, and it was elephant in the room. We had a big picture of an elephant that we got the artist to let us use. And the elephant in the room was substance abuse, parents with substance disorders involved in child welfare, and parents with substance disorders, domestic violence, and poverty. Really, the three drivers that drive children ending up in out-of-home care, and a couple of data points to reinforce that. Between 2009 and 2014, the reason for children being removed from their homes, parental drug abuse, was the most significant reason in percentage increase, and increased by over 25% in those 5 years. The data is not substantiating the fact that it's prescription abuse and opioid abuse. There's not research, but anecdotally, when I talk to child welfare professionals, when I talk to judges around the country, if you read child welfare in the news every day on those news clips, two or three articles around challenges associated with increases in children at home care, driven by parental opioid abuse, etc. A lot of work going on to address that. And in fact, I think part of my presentation is to talk a little bit about the Comprehensive Addiction Recovery Act legislation that is now tasking child welfare agencies with developing plans of safe care. Reason for removal is fairly substantial around the country. It's about 31%. If you look at AFCAR's data, adoption family, adoption foster care, and placement data, in Carolina, 35% of the children removed from their parents by child welfare is related to parental alcohol and drug abuse. The number jumps significantly for children under age six, and under age one, it's almost 44% of children removed due to parental alcohol and drug abuse. And we start talking about responses to infants born with neonatal abstinence syndrome, with prenatal exposure, the importance of well thought out responses to those families, and that's one of the fundamental changes in the CAPTA legislation that was passed by CARA, in that it includes plans of safe care that address the needs of parents and particularly moms, and not just the immediate needs of tending to the child who's prenatally exposed. Nationally, 40% of all children removed are under the age of six. So the importance of this family work and the types of interventions that both Tina and Judge Carmichael will talk about is really, really pretty critical. Our work with Children and Family Futures, I've been in Raleigh probably three times in the last 5 or 6 years. A shout out to Phil Redmond with the Duke Endowment that funds the Prevention and Family Recovery Initiative for four drug courts to strengthen family and parent-child interactions using evidence-based practices. And so we're the technical assistance provider and the conduit from Duke Endowment and Doris Duke Foundation in order to support those four sites and implementing evidence-based practices for children and families. So I've been to Robeson County, probably Judge, three or four times in the last 6 or 7 years. And then Robeson, as Judge will talk about, was a regional partnership grant, and we've been the provider of the regional partnership grants. We also work with family drug courts around the country under OJJDP, and we've identified really three things that are pretty critical in terms of this work, and the foundation of our work is really cross-systems collaboration, that the needs of families don't come to us as a child welfare family, as a family with just a substance disorder or a mental health disorder or challenges with homelessness or income, poverty, etc. Families come with complex needs. Our fundamental tenet is that in order to address the needs of families that come into contact with the child welfare system requires cross-systems work, the collaboration across systems. The child welfare alone doesn't have the resources nor the expertise to deal with the range and complex issues that families present. And it's even especially challenging working with families with substance disorders who present in child welfare. So we spend a lot of time as a foundation of our work around collaborative practice as a real fundamental part of improving outcomes for children and families. The second area is a multidimensional approach, looking at practice reforms, policy and practice reforms, things like uniform screening or universal screening, joint case planning, joint case management. Tina will talk about the use of
persons in recovery who've had experience with the child welfare system, and then practice and policy changes that at a minimum deal with looking at joint outcomes, and that's one of the tenets of the Regional Partnership Grant Program. It's really a huge program that was initiated back in 2007. The legislation was promoting safe and stable families in 2006, child welfare legislation. And you think about it, it's really groundbreaking for child welfare funding stream coming out of HHS to fund 53 regional partnership grants for 5 years, $140 million investment. And those grants were required to do lots of things, but two fundamental things. They were called partnership grants for a reason. An expectation for cross-systems collaboration between child welfare, substance abuse, the courts were applicable, tribal nations, as applicable as well. There were seven other grantees were tribal nations as well. The other thing that it did was the first time on a large-scale basis required grantees to look at child welfare outcomes. Those of you that are child welfare practitioners, the kinds of outcomes associated with safety, permanency, well-being, and link recovery treatment outcomes for families. So it was the first time that on a national basis, on a large-scale basis, looked at not just one outcome or the other, but how is the overall family outcomes associated with families with substance disorders in the child welfare system. So pretty, really significant. I work with family drug courts as well. Like I mentioned, we're the OJJD provider. So we've identified seven key ingredients that we think cut across this kind of work that can improve outcomes for children and families. One is a system of identifying families with substance disorders. So a lot of the work that we do is looking at how families get identified when they come in contact with child welfare. And I mentioned the AFCARS data because there's a lot of variability, that 31% national data around reason for removal. If you talk to practitioners, those of you that are either CPS staff or have been CPS workers will probably say that that's a really low number. And some states are as high as 70%, and some states like California are below 10%. And the reason has a lot to do with how that data are recorded and how a state identifies substance abuse as either a contributing factor or as a reason for removal or as the substantiation of maltreatment. Second area, timely access to treatment is really critical. And the regional partnership grants, one-third of parents who needed substance abuse treatment got access to that treatment within 3 days. Using that crisis point of engagement with the child welfare system to trigger cross-systems engagement in child welfare. What's critically important as well is how they get access to treatment. It's not just, here's a call, here's a number, call them, but an active engagement process that crosses across systems. Our recovery support services, Tina will talk about that. There were better outcomes in terms of retention in treatment for those parents that got involved with a person in recovery who also had child welfare experience. In comprehensive family services, a lot of the work that's coming out of the Children's Bureau since the information memorandum of 2012 around child well-being, a strong emphasis around parent-child interactions, and using evidence-based practices. So if you look at all the funding forecasts that have come out of SAMHSA and the Children's Bureau in the last 3 or 4 years, they all stress the use of evidence-based interventions to improve the parent-child relationship. It's not enough to do one without the other. In other words, it's not enough to just do parent recovery without tending to the parent-child relationship. Increased judicial oversight. We see that in family drug courts. There are other places that use early intervention courts, pre-filing courts, use a process where a parent comes before somebody, and it could be quasi-judicial, it could be judicial, it could be non-judicial, but something more frequent than 6-month judicial reviews. For a parent with a substance disorder trying to manage the disease, ongoing engagement and support and recovery, but also a degree of accountability is real important. And losing them for 3 or 4 months and then coming back and say, how are you doing, doesn't work. And it really is a prescription for allowing them, enabling them, frankly, to fail with that kind of lack of engagement. And then a cross-systems response. And then we spent a lot of time around collaborative structures. The data from the regional partnership grants, we've come up with 5 R's. Improvements in recovery, children being able to remain at home, reunification, preventing recurrence of maltreatment and reentries into foster care. Over 70% of the parents reduced the use of either cocaine, methamphetamine, or alcohol. And these grants were originally called meth grants because that was driving the, the child removals when ASSA was passed in 1997. Over 90% of the kids that came in that started at home when they entered the regional partnership grant program were able to remain at home throughout the term of their involvement with the regional partnership grants. 64% of the children were reunified within 12 months of those children that were removed. Now that length of stay is actually longer than some of the contextual data outside of the grants that we looked at, because most of the agencies, and START was one in Kentucky and is still one, and Robeson was one, tell us that the families had much more complex needs that took more time to address, including their recovery, but also other things like mental health issues and, like I mentioned, parent-child relationships. So actually they took a little longer than some of the standards in child welfare. Only 4.2% experienced recurrence of maltreatment within 6 months of entering the program, and only 5% of children who were reunified re-entered foster care within 12 months. And the national average there, when we looked at the data, was around 13%. I try to highlight some of those seven areas that we think are fundamental foundations to this work. The other piece of this is that this work is not easy on several fronts. I've been as Susan mentioned, I've been a CASA for recording guardian of my life. I'm a volunteer. I'm not an attorney, obviously, for 7 years. And child welfare work, bar none, is the hardest human service work there is, bar none. And you don't, child welfare practitioners, particularly protective investigators, don't ever get to see people in recovery, or rarely. It's right. It's rare that someone come up to a CPS work and say, you saved my life. But it happens to me. People come up to me who were in treatment 20, 25 years ago and now have families and say, you saved my life. And it's a whole different kind of experience. And so I say that, to put this work in context. This is hard work, and those of us that do this work really try to reach into the child welfare system and to support child welfare workers with this work, particularly as challenging it is to work with parents with substance disorders. The recent legislation, I've been asked to speak briefly about the CAPTA legislation that was passed in July, this past July, under the Comprehensive Addiction and Recovery Act, and there's language in there around plans of safe care. Now, plans of safe care have been around since CAPTA legislation 2003 and 2010, but Reuters did a news article this past year and found at most maybe nine states were in compliance with actually having plans of safe care. We're working with six states doing in-depth technical assistance around developing, responding, trying to prevent, and then responding to children's substance exposure, including development of plans of safe care. And we looked around the country. We couldn't come up with a single place and said, here's an example of a plan of safe care. Neither could the Children's Bureau. And the information memorandum that came out just a few months ago from the director gives some examples, some ideas around it, but there's little out there. Now, this not only does it require the involvement of the parent, which is really pretty sound, because we looked at 5 years worth of AFCAR's data, and over 80% of the children who come in contact with the child welfare system are either going to be returned home or remain at home. So the whole idea of family-centered work is kind of like a duh, right? But for all these years, we didn't quite tend it to that. The substance abuse side tended to the parent recovery. Child welfare side, tended to the needs of the child. But rarely did the two come together and say, how is this family functioning? How do we prepare this family to function, particularly families that are challenged by mental disorders and substance use disorders? So this legislation requires that, and it's also going to require, I saw David Kelly in the audience, it's going to require states to provide data around the notifications to child welfare from healthcare providers. The intent of the legislation was never to induce more abuse and neglect calls. In fact, the legislation speaks specifically, the intent language out of the actual body of legislation speaks specifically about notification in order to help families get access to services. And the revision to the statute does that. But it puts a greater focus now on monitoring, on being able, safe now being able to record notifications from healthcare providers, as well as a number of children that are found with substantiated related to prenatal exposure, those that get access to early intervention Part C services. So this is kind of a game changer. Even though it's been around a long time, with the opioid epidemic and the opioid crisis has shined a new light on it. Many jurisdictions are struggling with this. A high percentage of babies with neonatal abstinence syndrome, and that these families really require a different level of intervention, different level of engagement with the medical community, not just substance abuse and child welfare, and it creates an opportunity to work with families in a different way. And I think that I'm out of time, but we're here to continue the conversation after we're all done. Thank you.
That was a lot of very in-depth information about federal policy. If anyone has any clarification questions they'd like to ask Heather or Ken before we move on to more programmatic specifics, while it's fresh on your brain, don't be shy. I know you all took that in. There's also information in those packets that we gave you about a lot of this information, so you can read about it later. Okay, I'll turn it back over to Tina.
Hi, everybody. Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Right. Okay. I have a loud mouth, so I don't know if I need this or not. I'm really happy to be here to talk with you about START, the Sobriety Treatment and Recovery Teams program. And just a little history on START. I come out of Cleveland, Ohio. That's my home. And I live in Kentucky now. But Cleveland began the START program back in the mid-90s. And at that time, it wasn't a heroin or an opioid epidemic. It was a crack cocaine epidemic. Do y'all remember those days? Yeah. So basically, at that point in time, we were in terrible condition in one county, Cuyahoga County, which is Cleveland. We had about 8,000 children in care. 8,000 in one county. What? Now, that is including foster care and kinship. We counted both. And so that's, we had to do something different. We were putting babies in foster care left and right. And so that's how START was developed. So I want to fast forward to 2006, opioid pill problem in Kentucky. You guys probably know that Kentucky is one of the epicenters of, especially Appalachia, prescription drug problems. We now have a huge heroin problem. So we've completely switched over. We kind of missed the days of the crack cocaine cases, honestly. I mean, it's just such a big, you know, it's hard. So anyways, in 2006, Kentucky decided they wanted to do something different and thought, let's do START. And so I moved to Kentucky to kind of help with that whole effort. And at that time, around 80% of the kids that were in care in Kentucky had risks to their safety based on parental substance use. So Kentucky really looked at this as, wow, this looks like a really cool program, but we want to change our system. And that's what START is. It's a program that is great for families, but it's also a long-term investment in changing the system, as Ken talked about, involving all the other systems. You know that old word, silos, right? So anyways, what is START? So START's a child welfare-led program. It starts in CPS. You know, and we don't do a lot in CPS that has any kind of evidence behind it, so that's really what our goal was. So really what we do, we help parents achieve recovery, and we try to keep kids out of foster care. Now, sometimes that's not possible, but that's kind of really what we work with, is the family. We serve families that come into the CPS system. They can have a history, but they can't have an open case currently. It needs to be a new report. So we serve those families that come in with either a substance-exposed infant, that's how it actually started, and in Kentucky we expand with the population. So the family has to have at least one child between the ages of 0 to 5, because we're really focusing on that younger population. And if they're eligible, we have a really rapid timeline. We get involved probably within a week or two of the investigation ensuing, because we feel like there's a window of opportunity there. You know, typical CPS, we're doing an investigation, 30 to 45 days later, we transfer the case. Maybe the family might meet their worker a month or two down the road, and in Kentucky, it took 3 to 6 months to get into treatment. So, well, there's your ASPA timeline blown, right? Throw a relapse in there and you're done. So it felt like an inherent setup for failure for families. So that's kind of what we were trying to address. The other thing in START is that we really look at addiction as a disease, as a brain disorder. We now have science behind that, and what we know is shaming people and being punitive and going in guns a-blazing really does not help families. So if they don't come to treatment, we're knocking on your door. So it's a very intensive intervention. We do a lot of wraparound services. A lot of our kids stay in the home. We want to treat the family in the home together, if at all possible. Greatest thing happened in 2007. Ken talked about RPG grants. We signed on. We got one. We were so excited. And we got another one in 2012. And really what happened then is we had rigorous program evaluation and the most amazing technical assistance. And as a result of all that, we're kind of to the point now where we've just published our fifth paper on our research, and we are now in the California Evidence-Based Clearinghouse for Child Welfare as a practice with promising research evidence. So we're not the highest level, but we're going to get there because we're doing a randomized control trial in Louisville, Kentucky right now. So we're trying to get there. We're trying to build. So I want to tell you a little bit about what we learned. I could talk all day, but I'm looking at my timer, and I'm getting down there, aren't I? All right. So basically what we found in Kentucky is we were serving the highest 10% highest risk families in the entire state. With that, we found in our first study that our moms were achieving double the sobriety rate of non-start moms, so around 66% versus 37%. The children in START were half as likely to enter foster care, which is cool, which is really good. That's we want to keep them out of foster care. And at case closure, over 75% of our kids served by START actually remained with their parents throughout the intervention or were reunified. So we felt really good about that. Very low recurrence of maltreatment and reentry, between 2 and 4%, so we're below the state average. And the other thing we studied was parental capacity. Not only did they get sober, the parental capacity improved. Remember, these are folks who have not really parented sober, so it was really important for us to help teach that. The other great thing, finances. For every dollar we spent on START, we were able to save $2.22 for the Commonwealth of Kentucky just in the offset of foster care costs. So we cobbled together a bunch of funds to basically do this program. Medicaid, TANF, Title 40 waiver is what we're doing now, RPG grants, state general funds, foundation funds. So Families First Act is really important for us because we want to spread it. We're only in 5 counties right now in Kentucky. Indiana is also implementing START. Other jurisdictions have as well. But what I'll say to you is those jurisdictions interested need to know that this is a long-term investment, and it's really a systems changing program, and there's lots of readiness that kind of needs to be done in order to get there. So basically, you know, if you have any other questions, I think I'm out of time. Is that right, Meredith?
You got 8 minutes.
I have 8 minutes still? Oh my gosh.
How long have you been at it? Talk about that.
Yeah, well, shoot. I was just like doing my congressional testimony there.
Yeah.
So how long have I been at it?
Well, the whole piece, about, like you said, you know, it takes time to build and collaborate.
Yeah, let me talk about the implementation process. You know, learning about implementation science, there's actually a science behind implementation. We know this, right? We know it takes about 2 to 4 years to fully implement. So kind of wanting to think about, and it doesn't mean you're not serving families during the time, but you're really taking the time to build an infrastructure. So you can't. So for jurisdictions that want to do START, you can't just bust on in and say we're going to do START now. It really began as an urban model. It works really well in Cleveland and Louisville and Lexington, Kentucky, because there's resources. But we also, you know, what about the rural places? So the problem being, you have to build an infrastructure. So sometimes there's a readiness factor, and I know that I think Susan had asked me to talk a little bit about readiness, and I'm glad I have a little bit of time to do that. Readiness in terms of what do you have going on in the community? How are the services? Is there an intensive outpatient program to send parents to? Is there an array of services that will serve the needs of the family? What does the recovery support community look like? Is the court on board? Sometimes we can't go to a community. There was one community in Kentucky we couldn't go to because the judge said no medication-assisted treatment in my county. Well, that's a deal breaker since we have a heroin epidemic and we use evidence-based practices in START. Actually, our behavioral health providers have really built capacity through this partnership because we ask them to do evidence-based practices, not just for the parents, but for the children too. What are we giving the kids, right? The kids are safe, but are they well, right? And so it takes years. It's taken us 9 years to really get to the point of full implementation at 2 of our sites. And I will tell you, in Louisville, Kentucky, we just began an expansion. For every family we served, 2 had to be turned away. So we expanded under the Title 40 waiver, and it's been a year. And I have to tell you, it's kind of messy right now. It's messy. It went from a well-oiled machine to we have started over. And the reason is because we're adding more services, we're bringing more folks aboard, and you start over in that implementation process. We have 6 out of the 10 judges in that community are new. They don't know about what we do, and they're very afraid. When we come to them and say, we have a substance-exposed infant that is dealing with neonatal abstinence syndrome, and we're sending them home with this plan. People get really, really nervous. But when we can safely do that, it's a better way of keeping the parent engaged, not re-traumatizing the child, and saving money. So in a nutshell, it's better outcomes, folks get better services, we're out there every single week, sometimes 2 and 3 times a week. So it's really a paradigm shift in how we look at child welfare services, and I think that I can say to you, in the many jurisdictions that we've implemented START, it changes child welfare. It changes the office. I can say that in Cleveland, they said, you're hiring crackheads? They're a crackhead. I was in college when they were smoking crack, and we're saying, now come on now, we don't know what you were doing in college either. You maybe just didn't cross the line, right? And eventually what happens is these are folks
who become the resource for the entire agency. You no longer hear junkie, drug head, crack head, these parents are crap. That's the kind of stuff that you hear sometimes from frustrated child welfare workers. Mm-hmm. That doesn't happen anymore because they get to see recovery. They're the most amazing folks. Now, it doesn't come without challenges, just so you know, right? We've had a relapse. We've had folks to, you know, have some problems, but with a real good screening process, hiring process, it's very rigorous and a lot of support. Using peer support in a child welfare setting is an invaluable strategy, even if you can't do the whole START model. It has made all the difference. We have parents call and say, can I have a family mentor? Can I come to START? Mm-hmm. Right? So those are the kind of things that are happening with our program and how long it actually takes to implement. So I think I'm going to end there, because I think I'm real close now. I talk all day long on this. I never go under. So yeah. Does anybody have a question?
Real quick?
Yes.
Can you talk a little bit about the recruitment strategy? You said hire the peer mentor.
Yes.
How do you recruit?
How do we recruit to find folks in recovery?
Yes.
That's kind of a difficult thing when you're beginning. However, what we do is we look at, first of all, we look at the 12-step community. We look at other recovery supports, such as Celebrate Recovery, things like that. We look at Family Drug Court. We actually go to our child welfare folks and say, who's been successful? Who are your success cases? We also look at our advocacy. We have people advocating recovery at different advocacy groups about recovery in your state. We will look at lots of different sources, and here's what happens. You hire a few, and it becomes a huge, like, word of mouth, mm-hmm. right? Now, we'll do a blast to the Women's Coalition, all the treatment centers, all the recovery centers. So we have a whole list of folks that we recruit from. But the most amazing referrals come from the family mentors that are already on board, is they put them in the sober clubs and in their 12-step meetings. They hand out flyers. And so we have a whole different an array in, of ways that we recruit. And this is a paid position. I know lots of peer support is not paid. It's volunteer, which I think is wonderful as well. But they're part of our team. They're a full member of our team. They have absolutely the same amount of, you know, input as the rest of us, and so they're paid employees.
Full-time employees?
Full-time paid employees through Eastern Kentucky University as a contract position. They get benefits. The coolest thing, let me tell you this, is really exciting. They actually, we have an education benefit at EKU. And so four of our mentors right now are about to graduate with bachelor's degrees, which is, and they came in with GEDs, right? And so they're going to get bachelor's degrees, and they may be workers or whatever they want to be. So it's a really cool thing. Yeah. Anybody else? My time's up now.
One more question?
Yeah.
I did want to know about the actual therapeutic models that are being built into your program, so you know specific ones that are being used.
Say more. National therapeutic models.
The therapeutic models you're using.
Oh, the evidence-based practices? So really what we're looking at with our treatment providers, first of all, medication-assisted treatment, trauma-informed models, gender-specific treatment, there's all kinds of different curriculums, but they need to be evidence-based. We use the nurturing program for parenting, so our providers are actually kind of loading up on evidence-based practices. DBT was the latest one that we brought to the state. And when we bring trainers to the state, we bring providers from all over the state, because again, we're not trying to just make a little side program here called START. We would like to change the system, and so we try to make all providers get trained, and so that not only START clients but non-START clients get that therapy in that community as well. Did I answer that? DBT, the matrix model, seeking safety, helping men recover, helping women recover. There's a whole list of them that our providers can choose from, and there's some that we say, we want you all to do the nurturing program. We want gender-specific treatment in all communities. Medication-assisted treatment must be on the menu. Yeah, hopefully that helps. Okay, great.
I'm the micro part of the presentation, I think. And I will have to say it's a very unsettling experience for a judge to speak to a group that's not required by law to be in the room. I also have a complaint to our organizers that Ken touted his Italian ethnic background, being raised in the Northeast, his ability to communicate a lot of information quickly. As a rural Southerner, I should be allowed a time handicap, don't you think? An extra 10 minutes. I'll do the best I can with the same amount of time that Ken and Tina and Heather got. Let me just ask you this. If you're familiar or think you know something about Robeson County, raise your hand. Thank you. Now, without saying it out loud, I want you to think, what's the first thing that comes to your mind when you think about Robeson County? And the odds are, it's bad. It may not be true, but native Robesonians are used to that as we move around the state. The theme of this year's Family Impact Seminar is the intersections of child welfare and substance abuse. And for those of you that work in the field know that that intersection is not a place in the country where roads cross. It's a train wreck. And the bodies and lives of moms and dads and children just strewn about the countryside. We have an obligation as a system to make that better. We can do that, and that's what I'm going to talk about, what we've tried to do in Robeson County. Just quickly, just some background information. Robeson County is approximately 135,000 people. It's one of the most ethnically diverse counties in the country. 38% Native American. It shocks folks sometimes to find out that the Lumbees are the largest tribe east of the Mississippi by far. Nobody else comes close. About 32% Caucasian, 24% African American, about 8% Hispanic, and that number is growing with leaps and bounds. We're one of the poorest counties, not only in North Carolina, but in the country. State average, the last time I checked, for families living below the poverty line was about 17-18%. That number changes, but Robeson County is about 32%, about a third. Children living in poverty, the state average is about a quarter. In Robeson County, it's almost 50%. We have the highest crime rate in the state, and we are virtually unchallenged year in and year out. That rarely fluctuates much. High rates of substance abuse, very high rate of child maltreatment. Based on kids count data, when you look at investigation of child abuse and neglect reports, the state rate runs around 55-58% per 100,000. Robeson County, it's about 88 per 100,000. The last time I looked, the state average per capita rate for infant mortality was about 7. In Robeson County, it's almost 12. And in cases where children are placed in foster care, and I asked yesterday about this just from our DSS, children placed in foster care in Robeson County, substance abuse was either the primary or a major contributing factor in 75% of the cases. We're honest about it. California lies. We're honest. We're honest. That's to give you a backdrop. We did not have any kind of drug treatment court in Robeson County until the regional partnership grant started. And we will remain grateful forever for that. I got to know both Ken and Tina in 2008. It's like a reunion today. It's really an exciting thing. But we started what we call Robeson County Bridges for Families, a collaborative. And that's the whole point of it, as Ken mentioned, it's a collaborative. The problems are too great for any one agency, and certainly not the court, to try to address. Our collaborative includes the court, it includes county leaders, the Department of Social Services, and for those of you in child welfare, I cannot emphasize how much of our success is related to the strong support we get from directors, supervisors, and line workers. We would not be successful without it. It's just unbelievable to think about trying to go upstream without that support. We include the Lumbee tribe. They're an important participant in the collaborative, as well as treatment providers and other agencies, health department. Lots of groups are involved. Our participants are mostly moms, and the reason for that is obviously more often than not when you see these families, moms are the ones that have to do the job. A lot of times the dad's not ever really been involved. These are moms that have a petition actually filed alleging abuse or neglect, and they're at risk of losing their children, and that's our leverage. That's how we hold people accountable. Our original plan was that in the fifth year of our regional partnership grant, we would become a part of the state court system, drug court program. North Carolina had a state drug court program to be proud of. and in 2012 it was defunded. We're hanging on, and I'll talk about that in a minute. When we implemented our plan, there were some things that were crucial to our getting off to a good start. We trained as a team. The court system did that. The AOC did that. Trained us as a team, including our child welfare workers. We furnished a common basis of knowledge that would include things that doctors and judges and lawyers are woefully ignorant on: substance abuse and recovery. You look at those three groups, they know virtually nothing about any of those important, vitally important community topics. I was the worst of the world, the worst of the group. We learned how to share information when we could, when we couldn't. We had to decide who our clients would be, and they're the worst. Those are the people that you serve in drug court, the people with the greatest needs. You can make it worse for folks if they don't require that level of intervention to pop them in a drug court program. Their outcomes are worse. You have to be really careful. The most difficult part of the process for me was team decision making. As a judge, the buck does stop with you, and you'll read about it in the newspaper when it goes poorly. I was worried about team decision making. We staff our cases before every session of court, which is at least twice a month. DSS, our treatment providers, guardian ad litem, you name it, those folks are there. And I've learned that it is the most beneficial part of the job for me. I get real-time information. My decisions are so much better informed. I'm 10 times better a judge. If I'm a good judge at all, I'm 10 times better because of that team. And I'm grateful for those. I tell people a lot of times, I'm the least important member of that team because I know the least. But I've learned I don't have to be an expert on substance abuse, but I know people that are. They're right there in the room. Our participants have to have weekly contacts with the coordinator, random drug screens. They're assigned colors. When their color's called, they have to show up and have an observed drug test. Not just to provide a drug test, but an observed drug test. If you don't need to know what that is, you need to look it up. It's up close and personal. To give you an idea of how we've done, I'm proud of the work we've done. There's much room for improvement, but we've seen significant changes in our reentry rates due to recurrence of maltreatment, in the number of days children were in custody of DSS placement authority, looking at what we call our bridges for families, children. For reentry into foster care within 12 months, the last time I checked, for the North Carolina rate was about 4.5%. The Robeson County rate was about 4.5%. For similar sized counties, it was about 5%. For our children, dealing with families with the worst problems, our reentry rate was less than 2%. You can put a dollar value on that, friends. And DSS did, and that's what's kept us going. They put a dollar value on it. Annual median days of custody in DSS placement authority, for similar sized counties, it's about 393 days. North Carolina, it's around 435 or thereabout. In Robeson County, it was 400 days. For Bridges for Family Children, 299 days. 299 days. We've had increased referrals to treatment for parents for substance abuse, and as Tina talked about, it is so important. When parents need to be in treatment, don't say, here's a number, call them next week. You have to hook them up. And often you can do it with somebody in the room. You can't just send them out, particularly when they come in so often, crying out for help. They acknowledge they need treatment. Don't say, I'll call you Tuesday. You need to do it today. It needs to happen today. Their children deserve it. We've trained community professionals to work with families affected by addiction. We've secured licensing for 8 apartments, and this is sort of the jewel of our program, Grace Court. It's a residential treatment facility for moms where they can live with their children with permission of the Department of Social Services. When they're still testing, as we used to say, we don't anymore dirty. Because they're monitored 24 hours a day. Their treatment providers are there. They can finish their GED there. They bring them to court. They take them to treatment. We've established a men's residential treatment program. We've maintained a number of outpatient evidence-based treatment programs. Tina was talking about how critical that is. We started out with strengthening families. We've transitioned to celebrating families because the age group is we can serve more children. trauma-focused CBT, which has been a really hard thing to get started. The training was much more demanding and harder to access than we anticipated. We're doing lots of good things. So the question is, what worked for us? One of the things that's a pet peeve for me is to go to programs like this and people to tell you, think outside of the box. Well, I don't know about you. I'm realistic to know that I am not a visionary person. Thinking outside of the box generally requires somebody to be a visionary. This work doesn't require that. It really doesn't require somebody, a Newton or Galileo. It requires people that are willing to work hard together. And my theory about it, and this is pretty crude theory, but if you can't think outside of the box, make sure everybody's in the same box. We deal with the same people. They have the same problems, but we have different access to resources. We have different fields of expertise. Let's do our work together. It works for us in Robeson County. I talk to people now that I didn't even know their name years ago. People that are critical to the work that I do. They're my friends now. They're people I respect, those treatment providers. I used to have the false impression that treatment providers were pushovers. They're the toughest people in the room for an addict to convince. They've heard all the stories. You know, they're all from Missouri. Show me. I've already mentioned how important it was to have the enthusiastic support of DSS, and I'm going to just give a shout out here. One of the things that's got us off to a good start was a visit we made with supervisors and workers to a drug court in Durham, and Elaine Bushfan was the judge, and our people came home from there, we're ready to do this. And I've told Elaine that many, many times. She helped us get off to a good start. And you know that visionary thing that I've confessed that I don't have, and I don't want you to worry about my ego. I'm a judge, I'm an elected official, my ego is just fine. But I am humble enough to know what I don't know, and there are people with vision. Starlene, you're one of them.
Right.
There are people in the triangle that helped, that saw, that had a vision for Robeson County. They picked us when we weren't picking ourselves, and they got us started with that original RPG grant. To the day I die, I would owe you.
They wrote the grant.
They wrote the grant for us. And it's just an awesome thing. So what we decided to do, and I made this pitch to different agencies, I know everybody has more work to do already than you can do. That's true, Ed. So you can either whine about it or deal with it. We all decided we would keep our day jobs. We're not going to do something new, but by God, we're going to work together. And it's important to have cooperation at the level that you're actually working with the participants, like I do, the decision-making level. You have to have decision-makers in the room, people that set policy, head of the health department, the director of the Department of Social Services. It's good to have a county commissioner on there. I know a typical reaction I get when I talk about our program is, you had federal money. Well, nothing spends better than federal money. I'll admit that. It spends very nicely. That grant ended. The legislature defunded drug courts. We're still in business. And those evidence-based programs that we implemented that we had lots of money to do, we're still offering those because they work and you find the money to keep offering. We're the proud beneficiary of a grant from the Duke Endowment. I'm a graduate of Wake in Carolina. Duke's a wonderful place. So even when the AOC funding vaporized, we've stayed in business. One of the things you hear people in treatment say an awful lot to other people that are struggling with addiction, people in recovery say to other people struggling with addiction, and they mean it, it's heartfelt. If I can do this, you can do this. I feel like in Robeson County, we're doing great work for moms and dads and children. I'm proud of that. I'm proud of that. And I will tell each and every one of you here, if Robeson County, North Carolina can do it, there's no excuse not for you. Thank you.
So thank you all so much. As you all said, you could have talked all day, and I think you could have listened to each of you all day, truly. I mean, twice or three times as much time given to each of you would have been welcome, but we didn't have that. You know, you don't have that, but we want to open up now before we hear from TT Goings to give some personal reflections and give her an opportunity to ask some questions and tell us about it from someone who's sort of lived and contributing to and benefiting from and struggling with the system. We want to open it up for any of you to ask any questions of any of our panelists. We do have some time left, so specific questions, general questions, questions of each other, if you'd like. I have a question if no one else does. Go ahead. And if you could just quickly identify yourself, that would be great.
Sure. Hi, I'm Meredith. I'm currently getting my master's at Duke. Sorry to some of you. In public policy, but I'm also a child welfare attorney. I was working out of Colorado Springs. I'm a respondent parent counsel and also juvenile defense counsel. So my question, I think, is probably for Ken. With the wraparound services that you're talking about, a big thing that came up in a lot of our cases was actually that our kids were also suffering from drug dependence, often kind of stemming from a parent's either addiction to pills or opioid prescriptions or that sort of thing. Is that, are those sort of programs being taken into account with those wraparound services?
Yes, okay. Yes. Because of the high percentage of younger children, you know, coming into child welfare, so there's been a high focus around that. In fact, when the regional partnership grant started, there was very little emphasis around children's services. Now, I talked earlier about the kind of polemic between treatment focusing on parents and then child welfare focusing on kids. And so, yeah, we see some of those models. RPG, there are 21 RPG2s and now 3s, total of 21. So there have been 74 of these funded, and a number of them, some of them are tending to adolescent treatment, but not a lot. It hasn't been a primary focus.
Thanks.
How did you go about getting people who work for medications to treat? There's only one outpatient substance abuse treatment program in Raleigh area that will allow medication assisted treatment. Any ideas?
Didn't know who you were asking.
I'm asking the start person because she said their program requires that a placement is set.
Yes.
We're all for medication.
We have not arrived in Kentucky, just so you know, on this issue.
Could you just repeat the question so that for people who are listening in, that would be great.
So the question is kind of how do we get buy-in for medication-assisted treatment? Is that right? From especially your abstinence-based treatment providers? Or are you talking CPS or courts or all three?
All of them.
Oh, okay. Well, you know what? When I figure that out, I'll let you know. But here, some of the things that we're doing. First of all, what happened for us is we picked sites before we really knew how to pick sites without knowing what readiness meant. So we kind of just went to the big areas that, or the areas that we felt needed the most, and then learned that some of those communities were supportive of MAT and some of them weren't. MAT meaning medication-assisted treatment, everybody, right? Knows methadone, Suboxone, Subutex, Vivitrol, those sorts of things. So really what we do now, we make a very focused effort, first of all, to train our CPS staff, our behavioral health, mental health, substance abuse treatment providers, and if the judges will come. So there's a lot of training. We're doing a ton of training around our state. We do not hire folks or bring folks in to start any longer unless we know that they're open to learning about it or are open to that practice already. If you're willing to learn, that's okay, because a lot of folks in 12-step communities in particular are not okay with it. However, we're beginning to kind of have that philosophy of there are different roads to recovery. So we have that going on. Our behavioral health providers, that has been a very difficult, you know, the abstinence-based providers, knocking heads. Years and years of sitting at the table, kind of throwing down sometimes about this issue, using research, having folks come in that are actually hated MAT. And then she learned, after 10 years of seeing her dentist, that her dentist was somebody on Suboxone for 5 years, and it changed her mind immediately. Changed it. She said, gosh, my dentist, she's normal. I'm like, yep, she is. And so I want to say that I think that our judicial community has been the most difficult, because we've not been able, we talk about it with our judges, but sometimes the judges want to hear from other judges and not social workers or treatment providers. No offense, judge. If everybody was like Judge Carmichael, we'd be great. But again, I think it's an ongoing discussion.
education, using research, and just practicing, putting the right people in the right places. I will say to you, I can give you a real specific example. Lexington, Kentucky is the second largest city in our state. You would have thought we would have had start in Lexington, Kentucky right away, and we didn't. We are just now implementing in Lexington, Kentucky, and here's why. The judges, basically, that community was known for ordering people off of MAT, not allowing people to use MAT, but they wanted START. We said, that's a deal breaker for us. We can't go there because we have a heroin or a pill epidemic. And so finally, the judges wanted the program so badly because the outcomes were so good that the judges themselves decided to bring in the MAT experts from the University of Kentucky, taught themselves about it, called us and said, guess what? We're willing to try this. So here we are, ready to implement the program in December. So I think it's a lot of different strategies. That's just my opinion from on the ground as to how you have to, it takes a long time. It's a stigma. It's a stigma issue, you know? And so that's just my personal opinion. And again, it's not for everybody, but again, having an array of services and making that available. MAT, just keeping in mind, we oftentimes will say, maybe they need methadone after they bombed out of five other treatment programs and there's no more time left. It needs to be an option up front. And that's what we tell our providers. So again, we've learned the hard way and we have not arrived in any way, shape, or form. Maybe somebody else can help.
Well, so there's a values component to this. So a lot of it, I mean, the science is behind it. The science is unequivocal. So we try to do a lot of public speaking, particularly to child welfare and judicial audiences about the science behind it. The outcomes for opioid disorders without medication-assisted treatment are really very poor. I mean, like talk about completion of treatment, less than 20%, and relapse rates are, you know, in the 80% range. So the science is behind it, but there's a values perspective that has to be overcome. We try to overcome that with science. The second part of it is access. So I think Kara gives the Secretary of HHS the ability to allow office-based prescribers to go above 100 clients, if you will. So that opens it up a bit. There are concerns about diversion there. And the third thing, Starlene, is that on your Medicaid formulary, methadone has tended to be on formularies, and I think for the most part, Suboxone, Subutex, Vivitrol is very expensive, so it tends not to be on formularies. I don't know what's happening here, but there's an access issue that can help for those that are Medicaid providers. You're nodding.
Well, we have 55 opioid treatment programs across the state, including 18 that accept Medicaid, and there's a private self-pay programs, but we also have a Medicaid service definition for opioid treatment that pays for methadone, Suboxone, or whatever type of drug they're providing in the opioid treatment programs, but also for the outpatient buprenorphine treatment programs that are done by private physicians, Suboxone,
good.
Yeah. I just wanted to mention that one of the things that's worked for us in Robeson County is partnering with the hospital. They're very active in the community, do lots of good work, and we often couple training about MAT along with opioid over-prescription by doctors. Those things should be joined at the hip. But there are drug courts in North Carolina that don't allow MAT. MAT's the standard of care for pregnant women abusing opiates and opioids. The standard of care. Not to allow it, I've heard suggested, is a violation of equal protection. And it's also malpractice.
Amen, right? I just want to tell you one other thing that's kind of exciting and hot off the press. Our team just wrote a paper that is we just learned Friday that it's going to be published, and this is kind of cool new information. So what we found in our study is that there's a connection between the use of MAT services and child placement in our population. So what we found is for every month that a parent is on MAT services, they're 10% more likely to keep their children in their care. So if you're on MAT for 6 months, 60% more likely to keep your child in care. If you're on it for a year, guess what? 120% more likely to keep your child in your care. And that's going to be soon to be published information. If you're interested, I can send that out to you when we get the link. But that's pretty big stuff for us. So we're going to be blasting that all over the place.
There's a new publication that SAMHSA came out. Dr. Henry Jones from UNC, the Women's Center, Starlene?
Hi.
We haven't met. We've exchanged lots of emails.
Name and face.
But this is the public that
thank you, a consultant to the National Center around these very issues. Thank you. Nice to meet you. As my daughter would say, who's now 26, awkward. Even then, she reminds me of that. But there's a recent SAMHSA publication around a collaborative approach to the treatment of pregnant women with opioid disorders, and specifically for medical practitioners as well as child welfare practitioners. So it gets into a lot of aspects of what the evidence is around opioid treatment, particularly for pregnant moms, as well as the child welfare response.
Ken can correct me, but I believe now, if you don't allow Matt, you're not eligible for any sort of SAMHSA or other federal funds. So kiss those grants goodbye.
Yeah, the SAMHSA grants that came out this past year forbid any grant recipient for having a policy that would require a person to come off of or to not have access to medication-assisted treatment.
That internal state, too.
Great, so I know there are probably more questions, but we want to make sure to hear from Titianna Goings, who has joined us this afternoon. We're really honored and pleased if she was willing to share some of her personal experience and possibly give some guidance to the rest of us and ask her own questions if she'd like. And as the judge reminded us, the title of the seminar is Intersections of Child Welfare and Substance Abuse, Strategies for Supporting Families. So we've heard a lot about the intersections, a lot about the strategies. We want to welcome TT to come up here and then have her join the panel and let you ask questions of her and everyone else. We're going to let you introduce yourself however you would like to be introduced, but we know you would say so. We know you have experience in, you know, with, as I said, contributing to and hopefully benefiting from these systems. And we asked TT to speak a little bit about her own experience and to sort of reflect on what she's heard today. I will just say one thing. I hope no one has to leave before we are done, but if you happen to have to walk out, we would be grateful if you could take a look at this evaluation in your packet and drop it off on the table on your way out. It really helps us to plan for the next seminar. We would hear about who you are and what you did or didn't get out of this and how you might use the information from today. So if you'll join us up here, that would be great. Thank you.
Hello. I see some. Right there. Oh, right here. Hello, my name is Titianna. Friends and family call me TT. I'm here on behalf of Say So. If you guys don't know, it stands for Stronger Youth Speaking Out. It's a youth-led advocacy group where youth speak out about needed changes to the foster care system. I'm an SRA, which is, State Regional Assistant. I'm at large, which means I travel all over North Carolina and I go do link-ups, real world, different things with the foster youth, and then I come to events like this and speak out about my story and needed changes. So I was gonna go ahead and start with the questions that I was asked. First, I would just like to say, the question was, in her experience, how did substance abuse contribute to her entering foster care, and how did it impact her? Well, I'm originally from New York. Me and three of my other sisters and brothers got adopted by our great aunt and uncle. Living with my great aunt and uncle, they were drug users and alcohol abusers as well. Even with social service in the picture, they were very abusive, but at the same time, they were loving. We was never without life.